Today, Tesla stock was unstoppable last year, but lately it's been on a steady decline, falling 20% since hitting an all-time high in January. Plus, Macy's outperformed Wall Street's expectations when it posted its first profitable quarter in a year, as the beleaguered department store tries to recover from the pandemic's hit to its business. And finally, in America, the COVID crisis has killed more than 500,000 people, closed tens of thousands of small businesses, and left millions on the unemployment line. At the same time, hedge fund managers made more money than ever before. I'm MacKenzie Sigalos, and it's great to be back with you today. This is CNBC After Hours. A mixed day for the markets after stocks staged a solid comeback from earlier this morning when all of the indices were negative, with the NASDAQ composite down nearly 4%. So what turned things around? In a Senate hearing, Federal Reserve Chairman Jay Powell said that he remained committed to the central bank's easy monetary policy, meaning no interest rate hikes on the horizon. Now, despite the market's rebound, not all stocks were winners today. Tesla finished in the red. The stock has fallen more than 10% in just the past 2 days. It's also now negative for 2021. Now, that being said, Tesla is still up 287% in the past 12 months. So what's driving the latest weakness? Markets reporter Pippa Stevens can break it down.
It's been a rough few weeks for Tesla. We've seen two straight weeks of losses, and already this week, the stock is down a lot and on track for its third straight week of losses. So to put the move in context, we really have to rewind a little bit to 2020, when the stock posted just an absolutely banner year. It rose more than 740% in 2020, posted its first annual profit, joined the S&P 500. It was a really big year for Tesla. And then that momentum continued into 2021, and the stock hit an all-time high on January 25th. But since then, the story has shifted a little bit, and the stock is now down more than 20% from that January high. It's not unique to just Tesla. There's been a lot of selling pressure in some of the biggest technology names, and that's because these companies really drove the market rebound from the coronavirus pandemic route last March. And so these shares have been bid up a lot, and now investors are saying, with stimulus measures, with a widespread COVID vaccine rollout, some of the more beaten down areas of the market now look more attractive. So there's been a rotation from growth names into value names. And so that's hit on Tesla and some of the other tech names like Amazon, Apple, Microsoft, you name it. But then turning specifically to Tesla, there's a number of different narratives out there for why the selling pressure has really come to a head in recent weeks. One, of course, is just simply that investors are now taking profits. After the stock's 743% run last year, investors who have owned it for a long time are saying, well, I've now made so much money on this investment, why not just lock in my gains? Another theory is that there's a number of EV stocks coming to the market. We've seen a boom in SPAC deals with EV players on the rise. So investors are saying that there are now other bets for investors looking to capitalize on the momentum behind electric vehicles. And then most recently, Tesla announced a $1.5 billion stake in Bitcoin earlier in February. And Bitcoin, of course, very volatile. We saw a rise to 58,000 nearly on Sunday, and then come Tuesday, it was down to 45,000. So now some analysts are warning that the price of Tesla is now wrapped up in how Bitcoin performs. And since Bitcoin is a very volatile cryptocurrency, some people are saying, maybe I'll ease up a little bit on my Tesla position, which is what we've seen with the recent selling in Tesla. Tesla has always been a really polarizing name on the street. There are people that absolutely love it and believe in Elon Musk's mission. There are other people who say that the stock's valuation is way too high and it's completely detached from fundamentals. And that divide also carries over to Wall Street analysts. The average rating right now, according to FactSet, is neutral, but within that, there's a wide spectrum of where analysts see the stock going.
Okay, let's get to our sound check. Here's a roundup of the day's biggest action and what the top newsmakers and business leaders had to say on CNBC's airwaves.
We're going to have a much stronger recovery this go around. We're getting a bigger contribution from housing, likely from capital investment. These are factors with much bigger multipliers than the slow driving forward that we had in 2009 and 10 and 11. But still, the only setbacks came from when we had those big policy-related disruptions.
As far as I'm concerned, we have to take a preeminent position. This is a tech race. And I believe only two companies realize that and recognize that. Tesla recognizes it. That's led to their preeminent position. Lucid recognizes it. We welcome the competition.
We're a little disappointed that we're not at consistently 1 million to 1.1 million passengers per day. We had thought we'd be there by December. Last week, we had 4 days when we had over 1 million passengers and five with like between 900 and 1 million. So I think there's a lot of pent up demand, as Ed just said, A and B. I think there's going to be a jailbreak when there's enough vaccine out there, when things open.
Hamantra and I have joined together to create Slam Corp, and we both are very excited to come together and put our superpowers together. I think there's a market that we can go together and put some put our skill sets to work.
All right, so between the $1.9 trillion stimulus deal moving through Congress and the ongoing nationwide rollout of the COVID vaccine, things appear to be looking up for the American consumer. Now, one economic data point really illustrates this narrative: retail sales. In January, retail sales jumped 5.3%, which is way higher than the 1.2% that economists were expecting. The latest earnings report from Macy's underscores the same trend. The retailer beat Wall Street's expectations and posted its first quarterly profit in over a year. But, I mean, let's be clear. Macy's still has a long way to go to recover from the fallout of the pandemic. Courtney Reagan can explain.
So Macy's reported its holiday quarter, and it also marked the first time in over a year that Macy's recorded a profit. That's pretty phenomenal considering that we really are still in a pandemic. Shoppers are still very apprehensive to go to stores, at least in the patterns that we had seen before the pandemic. And Macy's is a retailer that is struggling largely because of the changing consumer behavior. Macy's stores are largely on mall, and malls just aren't the most attractive place for most shoppers to want to do their shopping. So early in the pandemic, Macy's stores had to close, as all stores in the United States were mandated to close for several weeks. And then when everything started to reopen, traffic actually returned in patterns that was slightly better than Macy's had expected. Still very far from normal, especially if you're a retailer like Macy's that sells apparel and shoes, office wear, when so many of us are still working from home. Macy's was not an essential retailer like a Home Depot was, or like a Walmart was, or like a Target was. So Macy's is looking at this year as a rebuilding and recovery year. Yes, they did just post a quarterly profit for the fourth quarter, the holiday quarter, but their comparable sales were still down 17%. Now, that was a lot better than the last two quarters, but still, that's the third quarter of double-digit declines. It's going to take a while to see things return to normal. And Macy's is not ready to come right out and tell us what that new normal will look like exactly and when that new normal will be. But what they do plan to do is to lean even further into digital. Macy's is now saying it will be a digitally led retailer. So Macy's shared that its online sales grew 21% in the quarter, making up 44% of total sales. And a quarter of those online sales were in fact fulfilled by stores in some way. Traditionally, online sales have been less profitable than a sale inside of a store, but today Macy's actually shared that those online sales are more profitable than the in-store. And that's going to be very important, especially as Macy's leans into this idea of being digitally led. So while things look better for Macy's than even the retailer itself had expected, and better in this most recent quarter than what analysts had expected, it is not one of the top performing retailers, particularly when you separate it out against those essential retailers.
Okay, let's get to the numbers round. We'll kick it off with $32 billion. the 25 highest paid hedge fund managers made a record $32 billion in 2020, according to Institutional Investor. That figure is 50% higher than it was pre-pandemic in 2019. 15 hedge fund leaders made at least $1 billion, compared with just 8 in 2019. The top earner in the industry, Millennium Management CEO Izzy Englander. He brought home $3.8 billion in 2020. These staggering profits for the industry's top 25 managers are the latest example of the two economies that have emerged out of the COVID-19 crisis. Now, while these hedge funders had their best year on record, unemployment in America hit its highest level since the government began tracking the data in 1948. Next, 10.4. Home prices continue their blistering climb higher. National prices jumped 10.4% in December, the strongest annual growth rate in nearly 7 years, according to the Case-Shiller Home Price Index. And here's the thing. December is usually the slowest month for the housing market. This latest data underscores the quote-unquote flight to the suburbs thesis that grew out of the coronavirus pandemic and the rise of remote work. Also contributing to the home buying frenzy? Well, record low mortgage rates, courtesy of the Federal Reserve's commitment to a near zero rate environment. And finally, 15. President Biden's $1.9 trillion COVID relief package passed the House Budget Committee yesterday, and it's headed for a vote on the floor of the House of Representatives later this week. It's expected to pass without any support from Republicans. Now, once the bill heads to the Senate, it's expected to face some hurdles, not least of which is the measure to hike the minimum wage to $15 an hour. That provision could end up being edited out of the final legislation, depending on how negotiations go in the Senate. Our politics desk is covering every development as Democrats try to muscle this package into law. Follow along by going to CNBC.com and downloading the CNBC app. And one programming note before we go, the After Hours team is growing. We have a few more hosts that will be joining the show, some of whom you met last week. After Hours will air every Tuesday and Thursday, and I'll still be here hosting every week. Be sure to catch us then.